This is our third installment of the Science World series, and this theory is brought to me my attention by one of my subscribers. By now you should know that any tip you might have, you can leave in the comment box below, and they could just end up generating a vid about a certain topic like this one did. Today we are going to talk about the doubling theory, also called the doubling time theory, which gets interesting at the level that science actually has, at some level, points in common with philosophy and religion, but more on that later. The theory was proposed by Jean-Pierre Garnier-Mallet, a young student of physics in 1966, and it surprised the scientific community. In his own words, the theory says that the doubling of time is actually the doubling of the perception of time. It starts by stating that nothing exists if it is not observed. In order to not slip into anthropomorphism, modern scientists use the most objective space and time systems of reference available. Or to put it more simply, a particle can always be considered to be the observer of its own time and its own horizon. The horizon of that particle itself is a particle with its own horizon. Thus, the initial particle horizon does not exist for particles whose infinitesimal horizon is that same particle. This theory provides the temporal and spatial change in scale between the infinitesimally small and the infinitely large. I know it's getting complicated, but bear with me, it'll get interesting. The time that elapses between a question and the answer defines an adaptation of time for a particle that uses this time in its defined space, limited by its horizon. Doubling implies that the observer is doubled as well and exists in the initial observer's time openings. The doubling theory allows for the calculation of universal constants like the speed of light and the fine structure constant, but it has far more interesting and mind-blowing consequences. Mallet's theory affirms that time doubles itself, but we human beings also double in what he calls our quantum double or quantum self. His theory relies upon this the basis that in each given second of conscious experience, there is an infinite number of other unconscious possibilities not manifesting themselves right now. We can use this in our favor to release suffering, as we unconsciously always receive a certain amount of information from the history of the future possibilities and apply it to the present instance or instant. Therefore, there is an exchange of information between the present self and the quantum self that permits us to anticipate our present through the memory of the future. Mallet summarizes this as: do not think of others in a way you don't want them to think about you. Sounds familiar? Well, it should, as Buddhism, Vedanta, Tantra, the study of ancient cultures and civilizations, and the ancient sacred texts all say the same thing again and again. What you think, you become. And this brings us directly to the quantum mysticism, a term that emerged from the founders of quantum theory and that this is described as the mystical interpretation of the quantum physics. Science wants to explain everything, every single detail of their surroundings and their own experiences, and then empirically prove it in a laboratory. But it seems that their own theories on quantum level are turning against them. The question then becomes, is there absolute truth, or does absolute reality exist? What does this have to do with the Mandela effect? Well, here are my personal thoughts about this. All the previous sounds to me like manifesting your own world, your own surroundings. At least on some level, because we are living in this world with a host of other consciousnesses who manifest their own life. From childhood, we are guided or manipulated into manifesting the world in a certain way, so we see the world more or less the same like everybody else. But wouldn't we over time at least manifest some, albeit small, differences that could account for the Mandela effect? Or could it be that some of the possibilities that could have been the physical world around us are retained as memories because we had a preference to it? As always, there's a lot more to tell about this topic than I covered in this small vid, and if you wish to do your own research, the links of my sources in the description might be a good start. If I forgot something or you have something to add, don't hesitate to do so. Your thoughts and opinions are much appreciated, so drop a line in the box below. Just be respectful in the comments, as there are real people with real feelings on the other side. If you enjoyed this vid, you can like, share and subscribe. And you may want to click the little bell to receive notifications. I have my You Decide channel you might want to check out. And from my corner of this science world to yours, I hope to see you next time. Bye.